to the third lecture about Genode. Last time we had learned about the programming environment of Genode, so the tooling that's used towards getting started practical work, and maybe to a simple scenario of creating a client server setup. So today I want to introduce you to the components that are part of the framework and the classification of those components into different groups. So the outline of today's lecture is as follows. First, I will introduce classification of the components. So when we built Genode, we discovered that not all components are equal, but there are different classes of components, and each class has different properties and different things that are important to consider when developing. And I will try to create a kind of sensibility for those different classes so that you can keep in mind what kind of component you are working on when developing stuff. We will see that one particular class of components is extremely critical for security. This class is called a resource multiplexer, and I will give you one example of such a resource multiplexer in a second point. It's about kernelizing part of the software stack. Afterwards, I will tell you more about configuration concept of Genode. I think that's a quite unique approach that we are taking. It is very flexible and allows to configure the whole system using one file or multiple files, but in a very coherent way. Part of this configuration concept is the routing of sets. So in the first lecture, we learned about this break-closure structure of the system, and this immediately raises the question of how to express those routing policies, and I will explain this to you. And finally, I will give you a brief overview of the components that exist today, so that you know where to look for starting when playing around with the system. So let's start with the classification of the components. So we identified the following class of components that have different characteristics. Of course, the underlying kernel is the most fundamental component. I won't go into detail here because kernels are very different. I will just give you a brief overview. Then there is a class of device drivers, which are the only components with direct access to the hardware. Another class are protocol stacks, come either in the form of a library or in the form of a distinct component, which basically translates one API to another. Then we have the class of applications, which is basically a leaf node in the process tree with no services. Another class that's very interesting is runtime environments, which can come in very different shapes and forms. And finally, the most interesting type of components are so-called resource multiplexers. I will explain this part in more detail. So first, one important thing is that this is not really a very strict classification. So there are hybrids between different classes. So for example, device drivers can be combined with protocol stacks in some cases. So when coming to the kernel at first, as you might have recognized, Genode supports a variety of different kernels, so it's not tied to one specific kernel as usually for operating systems. Normally, an operating system is built on one specific kernel, and so for example, if you look at the L4 runtime environment, this is specifically created for the Fiasco.OC microkernel, and it's a similar for our systems that we know of. So Genode is the only system that allows you to really switch to the kernel. And those kernels are the ones that are supported right now, and they differ quite significantly in terms of feature sets and properties such as licensing and stability, supported platforms, scheduling. So all these different kernels that are basically microkernels except for this one, but they have very different properties. So you might ask, why do we need so many different kernels? Couldn't we just use one kernel, less of that all, and stick with that? And The answer to this question is no, that's just not possible, because if there was a microkernel that had all those features, supported all those platforms, all the different scheduling ideas, all the different communication schemes, or virtualization support, this kernel would certainly not be a microkernel anymore. It would be much more complex. So features are basically paid for in terms of complexity. And by supporting the different kernels, the user of the framework, the Genode framework, can choose the kernel that fits best to the current application at hand. For example, at one day you might consider creating an ARM setup for an embedded system. You might use a kernel that supports ARM well, for example, the Fiasco.OC kernel or the Codezero kernel. And the next day you might like to create a scenario that uses virtualization of an x86 architecture. And for this scenario, the Nova hypervisor is probably the most appropriate kernel. So each kernel has its own pros and cons. And this little guy is a special kernel for us, because it's not a microkernel, it's just a plain Linux. And the reason why we have chosen to support this kernel is that it enables us to rapidly develop the framework. So most parts of our completely kernel independent, and so we can develop most part of the framework on a plain Linux, and once we are done, we can just compile it for any of the microkernels and use it there. So it's extremely convenient to run Genode on Linux. So, next class is the device drivers, and the basic property is that it accesses devices directly and translates the device interface to a session interface. Typically, device drivers use coarse services to access their hardware, for example, to access memory and I/O registers or I/O ports, and to respond to device interrupts. One thing that needs to be kept in mind is that typically a device driver has only one single client, because there's only one hardware resource that is provided by the driver. There is no point in having multiple clients. There are exceptions though. For example, if there's a UART driver that drives four UART interfaces, then it's of course appropriate to expose each of those UART interfaces to different clients. So this device driver would support up to four clients, but it would not attempt to multiplex one of those hardware resources to multiple clients. Another important point here is that the device driver should contain no policy. It is just a mechanism. It should just do the translation and nothing else. But even though it contains no policy, it should enforce policy. So if the parent propagates a policy to the device driver in the form of configuration, the device driver should enforce policy. And one particular example is the arbitration of device access. For example, if a UART device driver provides access to four UART interfaces, the parent might define the policy which client can access which UART interface, and that's the task of the to enforce this policy. So device drivers are critical. So we have learned in the previous lecture of Aaron that on most architectures we have this inherent problem with direct memory access by devices. So the basic problem is that even though the MMU protects physical memory from the driver code, so if the driver runs amok, it's typically constrained within the address space of the driver. The driver code can still access ICE via MMIO, so that's the sole purpose of the driver to access the MMIO registers of the driver. And the other point is that the device itself, it is part of the bus, it's a bus master for the most part, and it has thereby access to the whole physical memory via DMA. So, and those DMA operations are steered by the driver code that uses the device's memory I/O registers. So with all these combined, the device driver can implicitly access the whole physical memory, because it can control DMA operations. So that's a problem, of course, because the driver might overwrite the kernel or might do anything with the physical memory. And because this is such a huge problem, the vendors like Intel have come up with I/O MMUs that constrain the privileges of the devices, or the ranges on the bus where the device can access. but even though I/O MUs are a big help, they are not really a golden bound, because most platforms that employ I/O MUs do not provide fine-grained access, but a pretty coarse-grained control. For example, all devices behind one bus, behind one PCI bridge, are subjected to one I/O MMU, and there is no way to distinguish the devices behind this bridge. So if you have a USB controller behind the bridge and a networking card behind the bridge, you cannot distinguish these devices. So so this is not a golden bullet for solving this problem. So given this DNA problem, you shouldn't be considered to put all the device drivers into one single component or even into the kernel. So that's, the question is, doesn't this problem compromise the whole idea of a microkernel-based system? The answer is no, because even with no I/O MMU, isolating drivers has a lot of benefits. So the first immediate benefit is that those DNA-related problems are only a very small subset of problems that are related to drivers. So if you look at the typical problems of device drivers, typical bugs, you will find memory, for example, synchronization problems and deadlocks, especially when using when responding to IRQs and changing shared data structures. Then for most device drivers, most bugs of device drivers are the consequence of flawed driver logics, for example, that a state machine in a driver does not correspond well with the state machine that is implemented in the device, or during device initialization that some steps of the device initialization are just missing, or some residual bits are just written to, or something like that. So these are typical problems of device drivers that lead to instability, and DNA-related problems are only a very small, or not a very small, it's a big problem, but it's a rare problem, I would say. And the second benefit that you gain from isolating drivers is that the attack surface onto the driver gets reduced. So if the even though the driver is in some kind trusted with regard to DNA, an attacker has less opportunity to compromise the driver when the driver is encapsulated in a different component. That's the second benefit. So let's come to the third class of components. These are the protocol stacks. And as I said, the purpose of a protocol stack is to translate APIs to other APIs or to the same APIs. Typically, it does not enforce policy, but it may contain policy. So if you have a very huge protocol stack, they are typically coming with policy. For example, if a TCP/IP stack is part of the policy, part of the protocol stack, it contains policy, for example, about the allocation of TCP retransmission buffers and stuff like that. But another point is that the protocol stack does not access one singleton resource. It can be instantiated any number of times because it operates only on an abstract API, not on a hardware resource. So it does need to support only one client. In some cases, it is useful to co-locate a protocol stack with a device driver. And for example, an example is our port of the Mesa OpenGL API. Its implementation is done in a way that it co-locates the GPU driver taken from the Linux kernel with the protocol stack, so with the OpenGL libraries, into one program. And this is one option that we can do. Just taking in some examples, so protocol stacks can have two shapes. For example, they can come in a form of libraries. Two examples are the Qt set of libraries, which maps the Qt API to various Genode sessions. So the backend of the Qt libraries are using Genode's timer session, frame buffer session, input session, nitpicker session, and so on. So they are really covering a broad set of interfaces. Another example is the Lightweight IP stack, which maps the Socket API to a leak session interface. The second shape that a protocol stacks come is the shape of a single component or a single component that just translates different session interfaces. For example, we have a TCP terminal that translates a terminal session to a leak session, or an IP ISO FS component, it translates the ROM session to a block session, or the FATFS, which is the file system session interface that maps file system requests to a block session. So these are basically translations of session interfaces. But also, there's a possibility that protocol stacks map the same interfaces to the, or map one session interface to the same interface. So this is a kind of filter. Here's an example. We assume that in core we have the ROM service with a tar archive stored provided as a ROM module. So in core, the core has no notion of the content of the tar archive. It doesn't know anything about the format of tar files, but it provides the binary data to clients of the ROM service. So then we have a tar ROM server over here, and this requests the container tar file from core's ROM service. So it gets access to the file in the local address space of the server, and it knows about the format of the tar archive and can unpack or can decode the tar archive, and it discovers all the different files in there. And those different files can then be provided to a client using the same interface, using the ROM interface again. So in this case, the ROM client is requesting a README file, and this session request doesn't get routed to the core, but gets routed to the TOM, to the RAR, ROM server, and this server hands out a single file from the tar archive to the client. So this way you can transparently plug in a tar container between the client and the core, part of the system. So the properties of protocol stacks are that they are operated on session interfaces, so plain software interfaces, not physical resources. They can be instantiated multiple times in the system, so there's the course they are not depending on a single resource. They may be critical for the availability of the service. So for example, if the library IP stack breaks, then the program that's using the protocol that cannot do network anymore, of course. But they are not necessarily critical for integrity and confidentiality. So there are different measures how protocol stacks can be secured from the outside. For an example, let's say we have a protocol stack that implements a file system on top of a block interface. So and now we want to protect the integrity and confidentiality on top. You can just do this with cryptography. So just add a new component on top of the protocol stack that signs and encrypts the files. And this way, even though the protocol stack is used for saving the files on the file system and for the block allocation, the integrity and confidentiality of the stored data is not in danger. The protocol stack can be instantiated multiple times. There are no multiple clients of one protocol stack, and so there is no chance to have a protocol stack leak information among different clients because it only has one client. And so the consequence of these properties is that complex code should go into the protocol stack. So if you have hard process that is complex, then it's typically a protocol stack, and we should try to consider it as such. The fourth class of components are applications, so I will just skim through it very fast because it's not really interesting. It basically is a leaf of a process node that implements application logic but provides nothing to other components. The other class of components are runtime environments and resource multiplexers. Runtime environments play a special role because they host our child processes as children, and this is the only part of the system where policy is really defined. So other components might enforce policy, but runtime environments are the parts of the system that really define policy. And there are several examples. So we have learned about the init process that comes with policy, or is driven by policy. Then there are virtual machine monitors. A debugger would be a runtime environment because it subordinates the debugging target to its policy. Or a Python interpreter, it also built as the runtime environment. And now to the most interesting part, so called resource multiplexer. So this is the. I get some feedback here. I will just mute the microphone on my side a bit. So, okay. So a resource Hexer uses as a session interface, mostly the session interface provided by a device driver, and might access this session interface to multiple clients. So the problem here is that since we have multiple clients that can use the resource multiplexer at the same time, this property turns resource multiplexers into potential multi-level components. So such a component might serve both a client that is untrusted and potentially malicious, and another client that is trusted and is critical for security or robustness. And this must be kept in mind all the time when implementing resource multiplexers. They should be free from policy, so very similar to a microkernel, which is also supposed to be free from policy. That's the same for resource multiplexers. But the important part is that policy defined by parent must be enforced. That's extremely important. The critical role of resource multiplexers comes from the potential cross-client information leakage. So if we have multiple clients that we want to keep separated normally, the resource multiplexer might represent a bridge between those different subsystems. So we need to be very careful how to design interfaces. So for example, let's assume we have a resource multiplexer that provides a blocking RPC call as an interface. And one client would contact the server and block the RPC interface, and another client would use the same RPC entry point to contact the server. The other client would just detect that the interface is not responding in a timely fashion, so that there are some other clients talking to the server. And so we have just one bit of information transferred from the malicious client to the other client. So this is just like a cover channel. So, and this must be kept in mind, just that even the timely behavior of such resource multiplexers is important to consider. And another big problem is that since multiple clients are using the same server, that this server is prone to resource exhaustion, like based by one client. So if the server is allocating resources based on or prompted by client requests, so for example, a client requests a certain RPC function, and the RPC implementation of the RPC function at server side would allocate memory as a side effect of this RPC function, the client could indirectly force the server to allocate memory and consume server-side memory. So we need to consider this as well. So to sum it up, resource multiplexers are for the most part as critical as the kernel. So they are have similar properties as the microkernel. Hence, they should be as low complex as possible. So if it's possible, then this resource multiplexer should be implemented on top of the base API only. It should not contain or depend on complex stacks like the libc. It should be as self-contained as possible. It should work on client-provided resources. So the mechanisms that I explained in the first lecture, a client is able to attach a certain amount of resources to a session, and this resource multiplexer should use those client-provided resources for resource allocations only. And this solution comes in the form of heap partitioning. So it's possible for a resource multiplexer to establish one heap per client and dynamically allocated objects from those heap partitions. The resource multiplexers are tricky and are hard to implement, but fortunately only a few of them are needed. So basically, the number of different hardware resources limits the number of resource multiplexers that need to be in the system. So to create a kind of sensibility for those problems, I will give you a practical example for such a resource multiplexer, and that was created as a result of a kernelization process. So kernelization means that we take a complex problem, a complex implementation, and try to extract the security critical part of this complex software stack, put it outside the software stack, and execute it in a separated environment. And the poster child example is the GUI server. So if we look at the problems of today's graphical user interfaces with regard to security, we have quite a lot of problems. one problem is that a client may pretend to the user to be another client, a trusted program. So typical problems are Trojan horses, phishing attacks. And so an attacker is somehow sneaking in some code that looks like a trusted program, like a login to a banking account or something like that, and in turn receives information from the user, threats information. Another class of security problems is spyware, so input loggers or programs that take screenshots from the user without the user's notice. So this is one functionality that is, for example, built in the so-called state program used by the German agencies to observe their citizens. And another problem is robustness, because today's GUIs are not meant to be or not designed for clients that behave in a kind of malicious way with regard to resources. So a client may just kill the whole graphics up by imposing a lot of load on the GUI server. So obviously the GUI belongs to the trusted computing base of all graphical applications, and so low complexity is important. So if you look at the current implementations, this is really not the case. So when we started with tackling this problem, we considered an original implementation of a windowing system that I did as a diploma thesis 10 years ago. This is called DOPE, and was a window system, or is it still a window system that is designed for real-time and quality of service. And basically, it came out quite nicely, so that we at one point said, okay, let's try to use this DOPE window system as a secure GUI server. We had some basic security measures built in. For example, each application had a local namespace, how to name objects. So these are the different applications, different clients of the DOPE server, and each of these clients has a different namespace, So that's already in contrast to, for example, the X server, which has one global namespace shared among all clients. So this is one security feature. So there's only a local view of each client on the GUI. Another security feature is that there is a certain part of that is reserved for the GUI server, where the GUI server can display trusted information, for example, which client has the current keyboard focus. And the third security feature is a built-in policy of what to do with keyboard input or mouse input. So there's a built-in policy of distribute those events to different domains. So this is a quite nice starting point, actually. But it has some problems attached to it. So because it was meant as a without security in mind, it was prone to resource exhaustion. Because this is really tricky problem. But that's just an implementation detail. A second point that was often raised as a concern is that it provides a custom look and feel, and some people like it, but many people do not like it that much. So, and when using legacy software, it always stands in the way because it has a unique feel attached to it that is not in line with the legacy software. So, this could be solved as well with theming support, but this is not implemented. So, and even though the current implementation is actually quite limited in scope, the complexity is well above 12,000 lines of code. So, okay, we can discuss whether this is complex or not, but it's still, I think it's a lot of code to be ultimately trusted. So we tried to revisit the implementation, so to remove everything that is not ultimately needed for providing a secure GUI. And we achieved a reduction to about 7,000 lines of code. But in the process, we used a lot of cool things that came with the original implementation. So a lot of widgets had been removed, the command interface had been wiped out, and a lot of cool, nice, and fancy features were ripped out. And finally, the real time, so the most distinctive feature of the GUI server had to go as well. So, to cripple GUI, 7,000 lines of code already too much before. So, we took a different approach to look at the problem from 10,000 feet above. So, and asked the question, what is really needed to have a secure GUI server? Without considering any fanciness of any kind of link. And came up with a lot of realizations. For example, we don't need widgets. They provide no security feature. We do not need to provide font support or font management. Window local decorations are also not an inherent security feature, so we should drop it. We do not need a dynamic and powerful and expandable textual command interface. There's no need for any features like translucency or stuff like that. There's no value for security for those features. And also, hardware abstractions are largely unrelated to security. The only parts that are really needed are, we need some way to display information using a kind of windows or pixels on screen. We need a way to route user input to different lines, and we need a way to show the user whom he is talking to, so a way to securely label the parts of the screen that the user talks to. And this is basically the concept of the nitpicker. So nitpicker has only two abstractions, which is so-called buffers and views. So each application, well, in this case, Dope plays the role of client, or the X-server plays the role of client. Each application creates a distinct buffer, a virtual frame buffer, actually the nitpicker voice server, and operates on this buffer. So each of these clients can basically operate as usual, but they target their routing commands not to the physical frame buffer, but to the virtual buffer provided by nitpicker. And then, so these buffers are just invisible, so they are not visible on screen. In order to make a part of the buffer visible on screen, the client has to create so-called views. A view is a rectangular viewport on a buffer, and the client can define which part of the buffer should be viewed, and can also define the screen position where this part of the buffer should become visible. And furthermore, the client can also tell the nitpicker voiceover the stacking order of the views that belong to this particular client. So, but please note that each the client has a distinct namespace here, so it can only see its own views, its own buffers, and can just operate on that. Each client has its own set of views and buffers and cannot interfere with another one. And what nitpicker does now is it translates the local stacking order of those views and local positions into a global stacking order that is displayed on the screen. Furthermore, it also preserves a certain part of the screen for presenting some trusted information, and it has a policy built in for handling user input. So for the input event handling, there are some basic principles. So one principle is that input events are not distributed or not broadcasted to clients, as we have the case in X11, for example. But there's only one receiver of each input event. So input events are routed, but they are not broadcasted or not distributed. And the immediate consequence of this decision is that there's no way for spyware to capture user input, because user input is only received by one application, and if the application won't receive the user input, then it would not operate correctly. But so that spyware program has just no way to attack here. Furthermore, the input routing is defined by the so-called view-focused view. So there's one view among all of the views that defines which client gets the input. And this focused view is controlled by the user only. So there's no software for software to manipulate the focused view. It's only defined by the user. So the user is in control. There are some interesting twists. For example, one small detail is that motion events are reported to the focused view by the button is pressed. Also, when the mouse is actually outside the area of the view. And by doing this, we are able to implement all kinds of window policies outside the server in the client. So the client can implement the policy of drawing our window controls, how to move the windows, resize the windows, stacking the windows. We can basically implement all the typical window policies in the client and remove all this policy and all this complexity from the GUI server. And this is really the key for having a small server-side complexity. And of course, you might ask if a client can do everything it likes with the views, with regard to the positioning of the views. A bad behaving client might just cover up the whole screen with a full screen window and just make all the other applications unavailable. That's of course true. And for this, for preventing this from happening, there's a built-in emergency brake mechanism that just enables the user to freeze the current stream and kill that one application by selecting it with your mouse. So this is just an emergency brake once an application behaves somehow unexpected by the user. So the third part of the picture is that the user wants to identify the applications he is dealing with. So basically, one naive approach would be to label trusted windows on screen with a special frame or something like that. So there are several there have been several approaches to implementing this. For example, on the Trusted X project, there were special labeling labels in place around the window telling us that this window is trusted. But the problem here is that all those labeling mechanisms could be thwarted by a Trojan horse that presents just a picture of an untrusted of the trusted client, including the labeling information and capturing user input. So it can be thwarted. So the consequence is that not the trusted programs should be leaked, but all other programs. So you need to remove a certain degree of freedom from those clients and preserve this freedom for the voiceover only. And this can come in two forms. Basically, we can preserve a certain screen area for the trusted GUI. And Nitpick is doing this, but this has one disadvantage. It's basically that the user doesn't pay always attention to what's written on top of the screen or into in the trusted part of the GUI. A second possibility is to revoke the ability to use the whole color space and to subordinate clients to a base part of the color space. And this is basically called the X-ray mode of Nitpicker, and it can be activated at arbitrary times by the user using a special key. There's a called X-ray key, and it looks like this. So if the user toggles the X-ray key, the Nitpicker voiceover reveals which part of the screens are occupied by which client. And by having defined a policy for the different clients, the voiceover may even tint the different lines with different colors. So the user can uniquely distinguish the different security domains that are present on one screen. So here we have, for example, a Linux instance running. So the Linux instance manages those three windows. Then we have this launchpad window that was started by this menu here. And this is in yellow, so it has the current keyboard focus, so it has a normal color, and also the labeling on top shows the focus bind. Yes, and then we have this menu application, which is tinted bit in blue. So you have a very intuitive feel who you are talking with. And the second point is that there is a label contained in each of the screen regions that presents the identity of the application, so basically the chain of parents that are involved in the application. For example, this is the menu, and the menu has started this subsystem. So you see that here is a menu, and this started another instance of init and used and started into the launchpad and so on. So you have the full chain of components that are part of the trusted computing base written as a label. And the labels are not just in a fixed position within the view, but they are basically written at a point where they are visible. For example, in this window, the label would not be visible when it was printed here, so it moves over here in order to stay visible. So it's like a watermark. So the results are that we achieved to reduce the complexity of the GUI by orders of magnitude. So then looking at XORG, for example, this is far beyond 80,000 lines of code. This is without all the extensions, so it's a quite unrealistic number. Normally there are lots of extensions loaded, and this number is far bigger. And then there are several other approaches, for example, the Trusted X approach, the open new system, which was our starting point. And yeah, you see that Nitpicker is just far smaller than all those projects. So there's actually near to zero performance overhead because Nitpicker does not introduce additional copy. And furthermore, you might argue that now that we have removed all this complexity out of Nitpicker to the client side, the clients will become complex. But there's a counter example here. The Scouted Tool Browser is that is part of the demonstration scenario is just implemented in with 4,000 lines of code, including all the widgets and all the graphics routines and stuff like that. So it's possible to create trusted small applications that are using that directly. So we have those nice security properties now introduced in the system, but still maintain the compatibility with legacy software. So this is a really a nice example for a resource by the taxon. I just see that coming up with this idea, coming up with this kind of GUI hypervisor, it's not really as straightforward. You need to think a bit like outside the box to come up with these techniques. So, I think should we make a short break or should I continue? What do you think? Should we make this will be about duration concepts and in particular the routing of session requests. Because having all different components in isolation does not do much, so we need to stick them together, and I will briefly give you an overview of how to achieve this. So one problem that we faced when starting to work on Genode is how to configure the system. In our previous life, when looking with the L4 environment, we did a lot of different approaches. For example, we used the configuration of the bootloader, for example, some commands where to put up the stream mode in the grub menu as the data file. Then we passed command line arguments to grub boot modules, so these command line arguments could then be passed by the different applications, or we had a certain kernel command line that you probably know this from Linux as well, so there are special kind of syntax for passing parameters to the kernel. And of course there are a lot of different configurations files. So on a Linux system these are a huge number of different approaches, different syntaxes, and of course we would need different parsers. And also like on a past L4 environment system we had all kinds of different configuration files, and the user of the system had to know or to study the different ways to express policy in the files. So this was really unsatisfying for us to have all the different parsers and have the file providers having to manage the namespace for config files and so on. So we came up with a pretty nice idea for system configuration, which is based on a very simple XML a file. So basically, there's one config file that is passed from the core to a process to the init process in the form of a ROM module. And this has the basic syntax that you have already seen in the previous lectures. So this consists of a config node, and in this config node, there is a declaration of the programs that should be started by the init process and the attributes that are important for those different nodes, the children. And there are also the routing defined for the among the children, so I will come to that later. But the important part is that each child in turn can host a configuration node over here. So, and now you see that the recursion comes into play. So then the idea is that this line, for example, this launchpad, exposes such using this part of the configuration. So if the launchpad asks its parent for the configuration file, the parent will not just propagate a request to the parent and hand out the whole thing, but it will implement the ROM service, or it will virtualize the ROM service and hand out only the tiny piece, the tiny fraction of this configuration file that is relevant to the child. So if the launchpad asks the init instance for a config, init will just create a new data space, copy this part of this config into this data space, and pass this data space to the launchpad as the config file. And this goes goes further among all the three levels. For example, the launchpad might at one point launch another subsystem, which is basically again an init process. And here we have the configuration of the init process. So each time this init instance will ask its parent for the config, it will receive this snippet that's in here. So this is basically a recursive approach to a configuration. And you see that the nice property here is that you can configure the whole system using one config file. And there's an option to create those config nodes also by redirecting the content to another file. So you don't need to have all this in one place. You can also place different snippets into different files. But the basic concept is that thanks to the virtualization of the ROM interface, it's possible to have this recursive concept of configuration. And to illustrate the idea, I give you this small example. So in core, we have this config file, as you have seen over here. So this is basically a miniature cryptogram of this file. And so when the first init instance requests the config file, it receives exactly this file, this config file that we provided. So this is the file that init uses for reading its configuration information. So all the stuff that's written here is only relevant to the init process. And there is a start entry for the launcher, for example. So init starts the launcher process. And at one time, the launcher requests the configuration file from init. If this is done, init copies this part of the configuration file into a new data space and passes this data space to the launcher as the configuration. So the launcher receives this kind of view of the configuration, and this happens also in the next step. When the launcher launches a new subsystem, it creates a new instance of init. Init will request a config file and will again only receive a fraction of this config file as the response. So I think it's a pretty cool idea to configure a whole tree of processes in one place. So there's one syntax, so there's no need to have multiple processes or multiple configuration concepts, no command line arguments or something like that. The syntax allows for arbitrarily complex expressions, so you can have rich policies expressed using the XML syntax. You can, or each process, or each, for example, launcher can introduce a new cut text at each level, so you can have complete freedom what kind of format your XML snippet is using. And the nice thing is that the XML parser is extremely tiny, because it only needs to read stuff, it does not need to modify the XML, it just 300 lines of code, and so it won't spoil the trusted computing base too much, given the powerful mechanism that we have now. So now we come to the point to combine this configuration concept with the concept of routing sessions. So how can we express the policy of sessions routed between processes? I'll give you a short example. So the first thing we need to tell the init process is which kind of services are provided by the parent. So this is done using this part here. We just say the parent provides these kind of services. So this small example is basically tailored for the Linux kernel, just for simplicity. So we can just use these two core services, and there are no other core services needed at this point. Then we tell this init process to start an instance of the timer server and assign one megabyte to the timer and declare that this program is able to now announce the timer service board. It's the service provider for the timer. And furthermore, we explicitly declare the routes that session requests originating from the timer should take. So for example, here, if the timer requests the cap session, then we direct this request to the parent. So that's pretty simple, there's only one rule, and if the timer would request any other sessions, the request would be denied. And then there's a second start node, it's the test timer application, so basically a client, and here we say that requests originating from the test timer program are checked against this rule, like if the service name is the timer, then we redirect requests to the child with the name timer. So we will end up here. And if the child requests a log session, then we will redirect the session request to the parent. And that's it. So if this program would request any other session, it would just be denied. So here you can see that for each session type of session, you can define a routing policy, whether to route this request to any of the other childs or to a parent. Of course, if you have a more complex scenarios, these routes will get more complex. For example, for another instance of init, you would need to route all those core services explicitly to the parent. So this is of course nice to see that you have all those session routings visible in the config file, but it may be inconvenient at times. So there's a shortcut that we can use. We can generalize those rules by using wildcards. In this case, we can just replace those lines with a single line, like any service request, direct to the parent. And in this case, if the child is asking for any kind of service, then it's going to parent. It's not really identical because both things, because here we have a write list of sessions, and here we say just any service. So if a child would request an IO mem session, then it would be also directed to the parent. Whereas in this case here, the session request would be denied. So this wildcards must be used with caution, but they are extremely handy during development. You see here that wildcards can also be combined with explicit routes. So for example, if we want to delegate all kinds of session requests to the parent except for the request of log sessions, we can just have multiple of these entries here. So we can say if the request is of type log, then direct this request to the child knit log, which is a log implementation that is implemented in a child. And otherwise, if this rule doesn't match, we take the next rule, any other service will be directed to the parent. So it's very easy to combine bytecards with explicit routes. So if you very useful default is the following. We might redirect all kinds of services. We would try to redirect all services to the parent that are actually provided by the parent, and all other services may be directed to any other child. So this is one default that is very useful in practice for most parts. And this can be even abbreviated, so we can just there are many of those child in here or routing targets. So we can just say if any service is requested, first check if the parent provides the service, and then check if any of the other child provides the service. So what happens now if we try to instantiate the same service multiple times? So this might be useful in some cases. For example, if we have a nitpicker running and we want to have two parts of the screen presenting virtual frame buffers, we would use the nitfb program that provides a virtual frame buffer interface. So we would have two instances. So this name would be just ambiguous. And to resolve this ambiguity, we can just choose a unique name in a node, and explicitly say that this start first to a binary that is named differently. So this is the way to remove those ambiguities. So the important part is that all children of init must have a unique name. So now we can combine this hierarchical config file and the session routing. Even this small example, so now we introduce another node over here, a new init process, a new instance, and start the test timer program as a child of the init process. So then the resulting routing would look like this. So we have two start nodes. One start node is the timer, that is the same as in the previous slide, and another start node is the init process. So we assign 1 MB to this init process. And what is in here is the configuration of this init process. So let's first look at the route of this init process. If there's something from the init process, some session request for the timer, be directed to the timer, and any other request be directed to the parent. So that's the same as for the different slide. The only difference is here, this config node for this init process, and this is the different subsystem that says, okay, the timer service is provided and the log service is provided by the parent, because it's provided over here. And we start new child of ourselves using the test timer binary and route requests for timer and log sessions to the parent. So you see, you have a kind of virtual environment defined using this sub init process. It's really this could be taken as a kind of template. You could instantiate it at any time within the process tree. It's really self-sufficient. So another interesting problem is a challenge for configuration is that there are users of those kernels that like to use certain kernel features. For example, some kernels provide static real-time priorities, and users of the framework expect to be able to use those priorities. And so the question, of course, arises how to make those features available. The problem with things like scheduling policies and impact priorities in particular is that priorities may have side effects on otherwise unrelated subsystems. So in the previous slide, you have really seen this self-sustained subsystems. And so, like in a functional programming language, those subsystems are expected to behave the same regardless of where they are instantiated in the system. So if you have multiple of these instances of those subsystems, each of those instances should behave the same regardless of other trees that are besides the subsystem. But priorities really make a problem here, because if you have a global numbers of priorities, then priority erosion can occur. So if you have, for example, if you have a server that has a relatively low priority and a client that has a very high priority, the client might call the server, and the server will just operate for the client and respond to the request, so it would behave as expected. But now if you have somewhere in the system, somewhere besides the subsystem, another process running with a priority in between the client and the server, and this process would just consume CPU time, like within via an infinite while loop. This process would become active as soon as the client would give control to the server, because now the client cannot be scheduled anymore. It blocks on the server. The server has a lower priority as the spinning process, so the spinning process would become active and would never hand the CPU time back to the server. So priority inversion is really bad, and it really spoils the whole idea of the Genode hierarchic concept. And even worse, if priority inversion is combined with time slice definition, for example, this is an optimization found in Fiasco or Fiasco.OC, then we have the effect that time slice, that priority inversion is not always detected immediately, but only sporadically. So this leads to really hard to find bugs. So it's really nasty. So the solution that we came up with is to subdivide the priorities that provided by the kernel into a virtual priority bins. So at each level in the tree, we can assign a different range of priorities to different subsystems. So for example, in core we have altogether 128 priorities that we can use by the process tree. And this whole priority range is then passed to the init process, and init can now subdivide this range into two subranges, so a high subrange and a low subrange, and pass those subranges back down to the children of init. For example, this child will receive the lower band, and this child will receive the higher band. And again, this looks recursively, so this instance of init might split its priority range into four parts and assign different priority ranges to its children again. So in this way, we have the property that each subsystem uses distinct priority bands. So regardless of, so there is no interference between different subsystems anymore. So you can preserve this recursive nature of the system and still use priorities. So the configuration is pretty simple. If init wants to subdivide the priority bands into distinct parts, distinct ranges, it just needs to specify how many ranges it wants to create, and then in this case two ranges, and then assign different priorities to the different nodes. For example, this assignment means that this child will just run on the same priority as the init instance, and this range here assigns the lower band to the second instance of init, and this looks recursive. So to sum it up, in practice, this configuration concept is very useful, because during developments, wildcards make it very easy and very straightforward to come up with configurations, and those configurations tend to be very concise and very easy to maintain. And for deployment, we can just turn those configurations into a list of byte to a list of a byte list of routes. So we use explicit routing only by default. Second requests are denied, and only middle sessions get specified on in the configuration. So in result, we have a mandatory access control scheme in the configuration. And the good thing is that the absence of such bypass is very easy to validate. So it can be used. It can be validated by a very simple XML parsing tool. And once we know that bypass are absent, we know that this byte is really mandated by the integrator of the system. So the final part of the talk will give you a brief overview of the components that are already there and that you might use for your experiments. One way to characterize those components is to look at interfaces that they provide. So I will give you a brief overview of the interfaces. The log interface is used for debugging output. I will have to mute the microphone a bit. So, okay. The terminal interface is for transferring byte data to and from a kind of terminal service, so which might be a textual terminal seen on screen, but basically it could also be a UART interface or something else. The timer service provides a facility to let a client block for a given number of milliseconds. The input service provides access to user input events. The frame buffer service provides a facility to display pixel buffers on screen. PCI service represents one bus of PCI devices and provides functions for iterating over the bus and find PCI devices. The ROM service, as we have in core, is a very simple service that hands out data spaces containing predefined content. The block interface corresponds to the block layer of block devices. It performs read and write accesses of blocks on lists, for example. The file system introduces the file abstractions and directories. It uses the packet stream interface of Genode, so it's an asynchronous file transfer interface. The NIC interface is used to create network connections, so it's a bidirectional transfer of networking packets. So there's one stream of packets in the trunk inbound and one in the outbound direction. And finally, we have an audio out interface that is can be used for transmitting audio sample data. So given these interfaces, we have those different classes of components. So first, there are device drivers, for example, the timer or the device drivers for block devices like RTAP for EDA drives or the modern artists, the SATA driver. Then there are SD card drivers for some embedded ARM platforms, and there's also a USB driver that provides USB storage as a block interface. For input, there are device drivers for PS2 and also USB HID devices. Framework drivers are for PCs. There's a laser driver. For Linux, we have a SDR pseudo driver that directs framework requests to the SDL. And there are some drivers for embedded platforms as well. For audio out, we have ported original audio drivers from the Linux kernel. The terminal driver that is available right now is for the UART interfaces, so there are several of those drivers for PC UART interfaces or for embedded ARM UARTs. There are two NIC drivers. One is the NIC driver ported from the IPXE project, and another one that is used for example for the panel board that provides network over Ethernet. And yeah, of course, we have the PCI driver needed on x86 platforms. There are a number of resource multiplexers and protocol stacks that are now using the services provided by those drivers. For example, there are log services in the core, of course. We already have seen this, but there are also user level log services, for example, a server that converts a terminal session interface into a log interface, or a server that converts a log interface to a NIPPGR client interface. Or there are virtual SNP-SD or liquid shrinker for that convert nitpicker interface to physical or put it to the low-level frame buffer and input interfaces. There's nitpicker, we have already learned about nitpicker today. The terminal is quite an interesting interface because there is a quite a huge number of possibilities to use this. For example, we can use interface to stick two clients together using a crosslink interface, or we can have a terminal, a graphical terminal on screen that implements the typical Linux escape sequences, or we can connect the terminal to a TCP connection to the outside and can this way redirect all terminal sessions to a network. Furthermore, there is a resource multiplexer for audio, a small audio mixer. A resource multiplexer for networking, it's called NitBridge. So this implements an ARP proxy protocol. So each client of NitBridge appears using a different IP address on the physical network. So this enables us to instantiate multiple TCP IP stacks on top, which is very useful. The ROM interface is implemented by a smart component, a filter component that's called ROM prefetcher, which is used for accelerating the access to ROM files when read from the ISO file system. Then there are the ROM servers that I already mentioned that extracts ROM images from a tar archive that is in turn provided as a ROM image. And there's this ISO driver that uses a block session interface to access the disk and exports the files found on the disk as ROM files. Finally, we have the block session interface, so there is a loop device that allows us to use a ROM file as a block device. There's a partition service that multiplexes one block device and exposes each partition as a different block session. And there's a fancy a block server that provides a block device and uses an HTTP connection to fetch blocks from a web server on demand. With regard to file system, there are two instances, a file system that is in memory, a ARM file system, and also a file system implementation that uses the FFAT library to store files persistently on disk, using the block interface. So there are quite complex protocol stacks in the form of libraries available. For example, there is a C runtime consisting of the libc and a lot of those plugins. So this is there's a concept for extending the libc in a modular fashion. So we can use the libc as a baseline and then add certain backends to it. So for example, if we want to have standard output directed to a log session, we just add this library to the libraries of the program, or if you want to connect the program to a file system session, we just put at this plugin, or if you want to have networking or a socket using program, you can just add this library to the mix and can combine all those different backends as well. So it's very flexible. The second major protocol stack is the Qt set of libraries, which can be found in the Qt 4 repository. And finally, we also have the OpenGL implementation based on Mesa and Gaia-Qt. The final category is the so-called runtime environments. So these are processes that run other processes as children. So we have in the process, this is of course the most basic runtime environment, but it is one, so it's very, that belongs into the category runtime environments. There's a loader service, which is both a server as well as a runtime environment. It provides the ability to load subsystems on demand at runtime. So if you are using init, you only can configure static systems, but using the loader, it's possible to dynamically create and destroy subsystems. Then there's the whole category of parvirtualized Linux instances, for example, L4 Linux or L4 Android on Fiasco.OC or OK Linux on OKR4, which execute a complete Linux system on top of Genode, which is basically in the Genode tree, it's represented as a node, but this node is pretty heavyweight, basically. And those Linux kernels use Genode sessions as backend, so they do not have direct hardware access, We are all just running the software and using Genode block session, Genode mix session, and so on as backends. Then there's the Venko virtual machine monitor that is currently usable on the Nova platform, which provides not parallel virtualization but faithful virtualization, so the guest OS doesn't need to be modified. But that said, the current version of Vancouver is still in a kind of experimental stage right now. There's a runtime environment for executing classical Unix software on top of Genode that's called Nux. So this is basically an OS level virtualization approach that I will explain in more detail in the next lecture. There's a runtime environment for debugging, so it's called GDB monitor. This can be used to start a subsystem as a child and inspect the subsystem using GDB. And there are different categories of runtime environments that are basically language interpreters. We have Python and Lua available right now that can be used as libraries. So today we covered basic component concept of Genode and had kind of overview of the components that are available right now. So given the information of this lecture, you should know how to configure a Genode system, even a complete tree of nodes, and route sessions among those different trees. And this way you have kind of the big number of Lego bricks available, and you can start to combine those. In the next lecture, I will give you some kind of inspirations of how those Lego bricks can be combined. So I will tell you about different virtualization techniques that can be realized using Genode. And I will introduce you to a very useful concept that is basically the use of stuff services as children. And this way it's possible to sandbox critical or security critical stuff very easily. And finally, I will give you a brief look into the problem space of dynamic nodes. So, okay, that's it for today. Thank you very much for your attention. And if there are any questions, you may ask them now or in the forum as you like.